My research uses combinations of non-invasive imaging techniques to study human brain function. By using combinations of techniques, we can get more information than you can by using just one technique on its own. One of those techniques is functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI, which uses a scanner much like the one behind me. fMRI allows researchers to pinpoint brain activity with really fine spatial resolution down to a couple of millimeters. So you can localize the areas of the brain that are responsible for movements of the body, for what we see, for what we hear, for what we feel, for making decisions, and also the areas that are responsible for human emotions and how we experience things such as pain, fear, and anxiety. So it's a really useful technique, but the origins of the technique, its physiological origins, are slightly unknown and not very fully understood. fMRI is only an indirect measurement of brain activity. It doesn't measure the activity of brain cells called neurons directly. It records them through an indirect change in blood flow, blood oxygenation, and blood volume. In some circumstances, it's possible to get a change in fMRI signal which only reflects changes in flow and oxygenation and doesn't reflect the underlying neuronal activity. So my research combines fMRI measurements with other techniques to try to get a better understanding of all the different factors which add into the signal. One technique we use a lot is a simultaneous recording of electroencephalography, or EEG, which measures neuronal activity directly. This is done by placing some electrodes on the scalp, and you can record the electric field patterns that you get from the brain. And by combining EEG with fMRI and also measurements of cerebral blood flow, we get a much more detailed understanding of the physiological origins of the signal and what it really means in terms of the underlying changes in brain patterns. Towards the end of my undergraduate physics degree, I realised that I wanted a career in science research, and in particular in applying my technical skills to problems in biology, I found the application side of research most interesting. I was lucky enough to get onto a doctoral training course at the University of Oxford, where they specialised in taking people like myself with technical skills and training them to apply those into problems in life sciences, in particular with biology and medical problems. I quickly got interested in neuroscience because I find the myriad functions of the brain fascinating, and trying to understand how its complexity gives rise to the basic functions that we use every day. My research of combining imaging techniques, and also we're trying to build in mathematical models of different neuronal populations, gives us the potential to extract a lot more information, a lot more robustly, from these measurements. Hopefully in time this will extend the utility of fMRI measurements, extend the context in which it can be experimentally applied, it can maybe reduce scan times. Another thing we're looking at is the ability to study or extract parameters of brain function from simple resting state scans, where you obtain measurements of the activity of neuronal networks without any external stimulation. This is particularly advantageous because it's widely applicable and very comparable across many different contexts. And the ability to extract meaningful parameters of brain function and network function from resting state scans is a very exciting potential for diagnosing differences, perhaps in types of clinical populations. Science is always built up from little, small, incremental advances, but knowing that one day your research might add up to making a difference to somebody's life or to the way we treat or diagnose a disease is a great motivation to get up in the morning.